better roll them dice. You never know if it could change your life. Take a chance, you're neither wrong or right. You never know if you don't roll them dice. You better roll them dice. You never know if it could change your life.
Hello, Matt.
Take a chance, you're
neither
wrong or right.
Welcome to you and to everyone else to another episode of Dungeon Master of None.
I'm Dungeon Master Matt.
And as you already have guessed, probably, I am Dungeon Master Rob.
He's Dungeon Master Rob, the only Dungeon Master to have ever made it to the second round of the RPG All-Stars hosted by Paizo and get eliminated after getting into a prolonged forum fight with one of the system creators.
Yes, this is actually correct. no, what's even better is that I was accepted to the second round, and then due to some manner of clerical error, unaccepted. Gravely disappointing turn of events, yes. I forget which one of the creators is, but I called him out directly on Reddit for not liking dwarves, and he got really mad. Like, he has said, forget which guy it is, which Paizo guy.
I think it's Owen. I think they all have this similar name.
Yeah, but I can never remember them. But he has said before that that he doesn't like dwarves, he finds them boring, and I love dwarves, so I was like, hey, what's your... I was like, Owen doesn't care about dwarf people, and he was like, well, actually... And he agreed, but then he got, like, really, like, worked up about it. Anyway, love Pathfinder, love Paizo, but tension exists between Dungeon Master Rob and the official Paizo crew.
It was not Sean K. Reynolds, author of Consent and Gaming, who we like very much.
Yes, it was the other one, who we also like very much, but has problematic views about dwarves. Sorry. So, Matt, what are we talking about today?
Today we're talking about world building, and we're talking about world building BBEGs, big, bad, evil guys and gals, your villains of your campaign setting, antagonists, anti-heroes.
Yeah, big shout out to Nick, who emailed us, giving us the idea for this episode. It's a good idea, not what I had considered as part of like the core of world building, but after we got this suggestion, I was like, oh yeah, this is super critical. I have always maintained, especially when it comes to, like most specifically when it comes to popular entertainment, especially comic book movies, for example, that, you know, a piece of fiction is only as good as its villain. As I have gotten, you know, older and I would say more sophisticated, I have become increasingly disappointed with villains that are either two-dimensional or unrealistic or just cartoonishly evil, because I'm just looking for something a little bit more meat when it comes to villainy.
Right. It's why the best Star Trek series is Deep Space Nine, because of Gul Dukat. The best movie is Star Trek the Motion Picture because of V'ger. The opponents in some ways define your campaign materials. And role-playing games, you've got an advantage here, right? In that it's so character focused, right? You can make an Avengers or a Justice League because everyone cares about the heroes. Your villain can be, you know, not great, and
right,
you can still get by. It can be fine.
Yeah, and many an RPG campaign has been defined by a pretty tedious villain, and I would say that most villains of most written official modules are pretty uninspiring. You know, you've got your characteristic evil lich in something like Rise of the Rune Lords, for example. You know, they've got a story, but who knows what it is. Or you've got, you know, the bad guys just Tiamat or something like that. You know, a generally, like, you know, chaotic evil force. There are exceptions, right? Strahd is well known for introducing very early on a interesting and dynamic villain with a lot of story behind him. Honestly, Curse of Strahd is almost Strahd's story itself more than it is the character story. But for the most part, written modules or written campaigns tend to not emphasize, especially the big bad, right, the final villain, as much as they ought to. There are a lot of good ones on the way sometimes, but usually the final one is forgettable. I'm thinking of Kingmaker and like Skull and Shackles here specifically, where, you know, couldn't even tell you a thing about them.
Yeah. I think the big point and takeaway here is something we've talked about repeatedly when we talk about making NPCs, which is you have to define what your villain wants. So when you make a campaign world, you have to come up with some NPCs, some characters who want interesting things that are probably not what your player characters want.
Yeah. And this is a good chance for you to I guess, level up, right? To emphasize your skill as a world builder and a GM, to create realistic villains and enemies, opponents to your players that are not cartoonishly evil, that are not just big, you know, bowls of badness, right? This is a good opportunity for you to show your skill, you know, emphasize your chops when it comes to world building. As we've mentioned, you can get away with not doing this, because, again, you care a lot about the players, and it's really their story. So if your big bad isn't that exciting, that's okay. But the better that it is, he or she or they or it, the more compelling the campaign is going to be, the more engaged your PCs are going to be. If you can get them to really either hate or love or both your BBEG, that's a great way to get players engaged in the campaign.
Yeah, I think the hating or loving is a good way to think about your big, bad, evil person in broad terms, right? Do you want to make a villain maybe like Strahd, who the players get invested in their story? Or do you want to make a villain that the players just love to hate?
Yeah, you can have, and this is just a general, you know, fiction world building tip, is just, you can go either way, and, you know, in broad terms, that's the two really areas you should hew to with your villains, right? Either evil in a way that is enjoyable to oppose, right? Somebody, like Matt said, that you love to hate. A good example of this, I'm struggling because there's, you know, in big movies, there's a real dearth of great villains. Ozymandias is a good example of this. He's so smarmy and so self-assured. And in Watchmen, spoilers, I guess, because you don't know he's the villain until the end. But I think, he he's obviously evil and in the wrong, but, you know, in such like a competent way, like you'd love to hate him. Another good example, I guess this is sort of like where the competent villains come in, right? The ones that are just...
Yeah.
Moriarty is a great example. Sorry, I don't know why I didn't come up with that first. He's so obviously opposed to Sherlock and so obviously, like, you know, sinister in a way that is almost, or not almost, that is malicious to an extreme, but you just love the game, right? You love the challenge between him and Sherlock, right? He's a villain you love to hate.
Exactly. He's the love to hate. I think the one that the players can kind of get invested in their story from big movies that comes to mind is in the 57 Marvel movies that they made. They made exactly one interesting villain, and that's Loki, right?
Loki is the best example. Evil on the wrong side, compelling, interesting, sympathetic in ways, unpredictable. Another decent example is Kylo Ren, right? A little bit more, sinister, but you sympathize, right? You can see his pain, right? These are both great villains because there's no doubt in your mind that they are villains, right? There's no point at which you think that, even briefly during some of the Marvel movies, that you think that Loki is ever going to end up, like, teaming up for good as an Avenger, right? But you still sympathize with him, you still want him to survive, right? So you can go either way, and these are both good strategies for building a big bad evil person. But let's talk, Matt, in broad terms about villainy when it comes to role playing games. Thank you, oh please, I do what I want when I'm wanting to. My soul so cynical. So you're a tough guy, like you're really rough guy. Just can't get enough guy, just always so puff guy. I'm that bad type, make your mama sad type. Make your girlfriend mad type, might seduce your dad type. I'm the bad guy. Duh. I'm going to ask a broad question. When you're designing your campaign or your campaign world, do you need a big, bad, evil person?
I'm going to say you actually don't need a big, bad, evil person because, right, role-playing games can be so incredibly diverse, right? Your game can just be about players exploring the wilderness, right? The wilderness itself can be their antagonist. You don't actually need a sort of center stage villain to have a compelling campaign.
I agree. I think that this is something that you are probably going to want. I think it's something that players like and enjoy. And we, as consumers of media and Americans and modern people, tend to like a clearly defined antagonist. We do not thrive in sort of, you know, man versus nature scenarios, right? You can build a whole campaign out of that, but people tend to want, like, something to fight in a role-playing game. So I do think that you want a big bad, but I agree with Matt, especially at the start, you don't need one. And you may never need one.
Yeah, you may never need one. And one way to hold more cards in your hand, hedge your bets, is to do a sort of quantum big, bad, evil person. Throw lots of antagonists at your players. See which ones they really love or love to hate. And then that one takes center stage.
This is a cheap DM's trick that I use.
It's very cheap, but it's great.
All the time. It's so much fun. When you're putting together hooks and threads and, you know, maybe you've got some idea of where the campaign is going to go, throw a bunch of different types of bad guys at them. And see which ones really, like, stand out, which ones they really engage with. And then that one you can build into, a big bad or part of the big bad's organization or something like that. Yeah, this is a very easy DM trick to do, and you don't to save you from having to make that decision right away. But it's fun, and it works. Definitely take advantage of this if you're starting from the beginning of a campaign. Let your players sort of guide the game here.
Absolutely. Another big piece of advice is that you can always nest your big bad evils, like Russian whatever it's called,
matryoshka. Yeah.
You put one out there so that if the players easily defeat them, then you have the next layer inside be, you know, their boss, the person giving them orders, etc., right? Layering villains, easiest way to do it.
Yeah, you don't want to be too obvious about this. If your players keep defeating big bads from, like, the same organization, and then you're like, but aha! On the catwalk above, you see a shadowy figure vanish into an office. You know, you can get away with that a few times, but you keep doing it, and they're going to start getting frustrated. Same as if the villain keeps getting away, especially if you are bending or breaking the rules to make sure that they do. I am a big fan of villains that return, but you want to make sure that you are both designing their stats and or the encounters in such a way that they can realistically escape if the players are beating them.
Better way to do this, instead of stacking them up in sort of a vertical monopoly, is to have a oligopoly of villains.
That's right. Right?
Have a few to choose from. This sort of gives your players the option of playing villains off of one another, and it gives your world a sort of more living, breathing, realness to them. And that this is something, you know, most TV shows and movies can't afford to do, but you can because it's a role-playing game.
Well, this is something that the Bond franchise has been doing to great success, right? They've got this shadowy cabal of oligarchs, right? And every time Bond takes out one who's supposed to be the head of Quantum, whatever it is, you know, it's like, but aha!
Spectre.
Oh, that's right. Sorry. Spectre. There's another, you know, deeper, darker organization. And again, do this too much and your players are going to start getting frustrated. But you can do this. You can have a sort of a network of big bads. You can have ones that are not defeated return, right? But what Matt's saying is good. Don't make it just like one boss after another, right? Have it be a realistic network of related evil persons.
I'm canceling Rob for not realizing the true message of the Bond series, which is that MI6 was the real villain all the time.
I think this is a deeply
justice for Prime Minister Mosaddegh. I'm still bitter.
I don't think this is a reading of the Bond franchise that was intended. However, as we all know, the author is dead, so fair enough. Yeah, actually, MI6 is the real villain.
Yeah, it's incredibly obvious. They're misogynistic, colonialist. They're the bad guys.
They take little boys from orphanages and turn them into murderous, rape killing machines.
Is that what Bond is? He's
an orphan, right? I think that was what the story was in. It's been retconned, but that's what it was in Skyfall, right? He was an orphan.
I hate the new films. I'm Pierce Brosnan or get the fuck out.
Fair enough. I don't hate Daniel Craig Bond. You can cancel me for that, but Pierce Brosnan is Bond and will always be Bond.
I'm sorry. You prefer your Bond with just a ton of ball-thwacking scenes. Just like, well, you know, what if we put a 5-minute ball-thwacking scene on here?
Listen, Matt clearly doesn't appreciate fine cinema. But let's talk...
I'm just pissed they changed the game from Baccarat, King's Game, a gentleman's game, to Texas Hold'em. Actually, I don't understand Baccarat.
I was thinking about that. I'm like, I don't even know how to play Baccarat, but that would have been interesting.
Choose your next witticism carefully, Mr. Bond. It may be your last. The purpose of our two previous encounters is now very clear to me. I do not intend to be distracted by another. Good night, Mr. Bond.
Do you expect me to talk?
No, Mr. Bond, I expect you to die.
So what else about, like, broadly? So what does a big bad bring to a campaign, right? So everything that we talk about with world building is background, right? It is the underlying superstructure that helps sort of guide your actual gameplay, right? It's not always critical or immediately obvious. So if we think of a big bad as a world building element, what does it bring to your campaign? What does it provide that, for example, setting provides, or having a history, or, you know, factions?
For me, a villain, I want to deploy them in two ways. One, to motivate the players, right? A villain can bring out your players' motivations more clearly than most other things besides treasure and XP. Second is if you already have a campaign or a story where players have strong motivations, right? It's just an extension of that. It can be a force to stop your players from doing whatever it is that motivates them.
Yeah, I agree with Matt very strongly here. It's my favorite tool to use as motivation. It is a great way to get your players invested and to give them a direction, right? They're going to want to uncover and oppose this villain if you do it right. And it's also a great tool, like Matt said. A villain is a great way to push players in a certain direction, or to close off avenues, or to, you know, bring the campaign in a way that you can control it or make sense of it. In a way that works, right? That's not railroady, that is organic to the setting into the game. A good villain is an important part of a DM's toolbox in guiding the way that your campaign is going to run.
Well, shall we get specific then? Unless you have other broad points you want to bring up about villainy?
No, I don't think so. Like I said at the beginning, this is not a core part of your world-building regimen, but I think, as I've discussed, this is what separates the fighters from the warriors, Matt. It's what makes a GM above and beyond is being able to craft a compelling, realistic villain with motivations that make sense and work within the world. And I think this is something that you should try for it is hard to do. You often have to respond to what your players care about and work with that. But it's I think it's a really, really great way to get your players to invest in your world. This is, I think, especially important for homebrew worlds, where you have to do a lot of the heavy lifting yourself. If you can drop a villain in to engage your characters and to sort of tie to other critical parts of your world building that you want to highlight, that's a really great way to do some of the work that you can't do because you're just one person and not a whole team building a book, right?
Be prepared for sensational news. A shining new era is tiptoeing nearer.
And where do we feature?
Just listen to teacher. I know it sounds sordid, but you'll be rewarded when at last I am given my dues. And injustice deliciously square. Be prepared.
Yeah, be prepared.
Okay, well, since we're transitioning from broad to specific, I think as we talk about some specific villains, we want to think about, you know, a couple, you know, broad specific categories to keep in mind while building villains. Like, what is, most importantly, this villain's motivation? What is their shtick, right? How do they affect change in the world? I think if you have those two, that's basically what you need.
Yeah, you need a motivation. A motivation
and
a method.
And how they do it.
Yeah, that's basically it. So let's talk about grouping villains into categories would be the, you know, the work of an entire like literary theory course. But let's broadly talk about some archetypes, right, Matt? So one of my favorites from recent history, and this has included basically every villain from every major comic book movie or action movie franchise in the past 10 years, is the misguided zealot, right? So this is the guy who wants to end human civilization because he loves the environment, right? Humans are a plague on the earth and they are destroying beautiful nature and we don't deserve to live. Or more mildly, right, this is a revolutionary who goes too far. Right? Both my favorite and least favorite archetype from any movie is, you know, somebody who's got the right idea, but he's too dangerous. He goes too far, or he's lost his way, right? He says he wants to make the world equal, but really he's just acting out of pain and vengeance for his lost wife or something, you know?
Yeah. Usually, if you don't know what else to do, just make sure they have a dead wife.
Dead wife is a great way to...
No, it's not.
Don't do that. This is called fridging. Look up the trope. Don't do this. This is not a good way to motivate anybody. Yeah.
I love the misguided zealot, right? Your Thanoses, your Killmongers. I will add my sort of favorite villain, which is... I don't have a good name for, but... The person who wants out. They've been assigned some sort of role by the higher powers, and they're willing to do whatever it takes to move themselves out of their situation or into a back into control, right? Usually someone who's been demoted or cast aside by whatever villainous or good organization they work for. Your Agent Smiths, for example.
Yeah, this is a good one, too. This is also great in a RPG setting because they can be... This works very well as fallen paladins or blackguards or clerics of a god that no longer believe. The villain from Avernus that we talked about, whose name I have completely forgotten, the guy who plunges Elturiel into the depths is a little bit like this, right? He has lost his faith and just wants, you know, to... be done with the whole thing. Now, this is a great one, and what's great about this is they've got a clear motivation, right, and a clear end point, so you can easily understand their motivations, and your players, once they realize what they're after, can understand it. Agent Smith is a good one, too. They want out. They want to be done with this assignment, right?
Yeah. They just want their job to end.
Yeah.
They just want to quit their job and they can't, is basically.
This is great also for make any, like, fallen angel or something like. They just have come to hate their wards, right? They've come to hate humanity, and so they've gone bad. That's like a trope, but that's a great villain for any stage of your campaign. You know, mortals are just so loathsome that even the people who are supposed to, the celestial beings that are meant to watch over them can't bear them any longer.
Yeah. What's another archetype?
Well, one of the least, this isn't innovative, but it's a good one. The oligarch, the man in charge, right? This is a person who is used to having control and wants to exert or maintain control, and they will do anything in their power to prevent people from, you know, from changing that. So this is your standard tyrannical king, or a heavy-handed sheriff or something like that. This can go from the very smallest to very largest, and it's not the most interesting, but within the archetype you can create some very interesting characters. So the question then becomes, why do they want to maintain control? What are their motivations for staying king, or keeping their chosen king on the throne, or keeping the, you know, theocratic government in place? What is their reasoning behind that?
Yeah, and I think the man, as we'll call this archetype,
the man is a good
works really, really well in most RPGs, because if you're having that sort of open-ended sandbox-type campaign, right, and you're sort of waiting to see what your players are doing and interested in, right, you don't really have to think too hard about exactly how this person is actively moving in the world.
Yeah, this creates, there's nothing wrong with having a very simple, straightforward, you know, a band of rebels story, right? There's nothing wrong with doing your Star Wars or Final Fantasy game. It's a lot of fun. You could do tell a lot of interesting and unique stories that way. So this is a perfectly good villain. The place to innovate here is to ask yourself, rather than just saying, oh, he's a king, and so he wants to stay king, ask yourself why the villain, you know, make them somebody like a bishop or a high-ranking major domo or something. And what is their attachment?
Or a god.
Or a god, right? What is their attachment to order, right? Why are they the man, or why are they supporting the man? And then, you know, your players then oppose that. And they would toast to me, let the players play. I'd be just like Leo in Saint-Tropez. Fast as I can, wondering if I'd get there quick or if I was a man. And I'm so sick of them coming at me again, 'cause if I was a man, then I'd be the man.
My next one is one I like to call the Ender. Not because they like to end things, but they think of ends over means. And this overlaps a little bit with the zealot, but this is your, actually, I'm a good person, but the things I am willing to do for the good are in fact will be quite bad for the player characters and the people they care about. So I think it differs a little bit from the zealot in that, they're not, as opposed to a zealot who truly believes in something good, you know, they can be a little more flexible, right? They are often doing very, very good things, yet they're often doing very, very evil things, all for an outcome the players will actually appreciate.
Yeah, they're more deterministic than the zealot, which is a belief, right, or faith-driven person. Now, this is good. This is a variation on, and a really good one. One of my favorites. This is a great, if you want to really tie your players up in knots, you know, give them a villain who is really wants something that they want, right? Or that they should want, but is maybe going just like a little bit too far, or just like a little bit outside the realm. And then maybe they get more and more, and your players maybe, identify with them, but are struggling. Maybe the person that the Ender is opposing is as bad, right? Or maybe worse somehow. Or, you know, the outcome is uncertain. This is a great way for like morally gray campaigns to work. It's harder to build, but it's a lot of fun.
I like making my Enders like a righteous queen or a mm-hmm. good president, right? And they look at the world in very practical terms, and they say, well, I'm going to start this war in which, millions of people die because I know that the solution of reclaiming the Rod of Seven Parts is too far-fetched and only has a 1 in a million chance to work.
Right,
this
right.
way, we minimize our losses and can defeat the evil empire that will soon attack with just a terrible and bloody war, which will, of course, sacrifice the player's hometown, but it will at least prevent the apocalypse.
Yeah, this is one of my favorites, and it's challenging to do right, but it's a good villain.
You can make this person a lawful good or neutral good, right?
Mm-hmm.
They care about others. They are empathetic. They just value the ends over the means.
And this brings up something that I wanted to mention early on, which is that very few people in real life consider themselves a villain, right? They do not think that they are a bad person. In fact, they think that what they're doing is right. Almost everybody believes that what they're doing is
Henry Kissinger. Yeah, we get what you're saying, Rob.
Thank you, Matt. The point is, I know that this is perhaps not news, but make sure that when you are building your villains, that they're not just... that if they're going to, execute somebody in horrific fashion, that they have a good reason for doing so. That they believe they are doing the right thing. There are exceptions to this rule. I have found out this used to be an unshakable belief of mine. And then I have watched people in real life who seem to identify with being the bad guy, revel in it. So that's been, I'm not sure if this is entirely as true as I thought that it was, but generally most people believe themselves to be doing what is right for themselves and others. They just they are often misguided.
And here's where you can, take all this advice and say, stuff it and have just as much fun creating a villain that is a force of pure evil, right?
Yes, this is the iconic dragon, right? Just an evil dragon or an insane clown, for example, somebody who's just evil for the sake of evil. And even though we spent all this time talking about how your villains should have motivations and should, make sense... we all love a, dragon enemy and an insane clown enemy. The Joker is a great bad guy, even though he, by his own admission and by every piece of writing and everything he's ever been in, has absolutely no, overriding goal beyond kill the Batman and, cause chaos. Which totally works in the context of the Gotham Batman comic book setting.
Another one that sort of builds off one of our earlier ones, the man is the sidekick, right? Whose Ooh. Motivations is just they want to impress someone else, right? That's why I'm shooting Reagan.
This is such a good one. Yeah, this is also like this villain, because this was the original Thanos, was that he wanted to impress the goddess of death, which honestly was a more... in many ways, a more realistic motivation than...
Somehow that made more sense.
It made more sense than this. Perfectly balanced. Anyway. It's also, a great way to build a villain with pathos, right? They're trying to, impress somebody, and it's sad in a way, but also horrifying.
Or a villain that can, change and evolve. If you want one of those really bad, I'm thinking of the early Harley Quinn stories where
uh-huh.
she's a character who just wants the Joker to love her, and then eventually she becomes a villain in her own right.
This
or could be redeemed, maybe.
This is a good one for where you might want to use a dead wife or father or mother or something like that, and the villain, on their deathbed, this loved one, a mentor, was like, I want you to do this thing, right? And so that's what they're going to do, because they made an oath to do this thing no matter how far they had to go, no matter what, they're going to finish this task, even if it means, burning down the seven towers of, Asgard or something like that, because that's what they said they would do.
Okay, here's my last archetype, Rob, and stop me when you know who I am. My ventilation ducts will never be too small to crawl through. My legions of terror will have helmets with clear plexiglass visors, not face-concealing ones. The hero
the mastermind.
Is not entitled.
The mastermind, right?
The mastermind, the competent villain,
yes,
right?
The competent villain.
Who really, you know, maybe this is the opposite over of the Ender, and this is maybe for a slightly jokier campaign. If you remember from the earliest days of the internet, Peter's evil overlord list, right?
It's a great list. It's a great list.
It's also a good thing
to read to avoid, like, really dumb. I mean, go ahead and put some ventilation shafts in there. Go ahead and make the guards dumb. But, like, if you want to avoid tropes,
I will never turn into a snake. It never helps.
It never helps. This is a good one. It can be very...
If an advisor says to me, my liege, he is but one man, what can one man possibly do? I will reply this and kill the advisor.
Yeah, it can be fun. Player villains, as if they're as smart as you are or as smart as your players are, you know, obvious...
The competence porn villain, right?
Yes.
Or she just likes being good at being bad.
Here's what's difficult about this, though, is that you have to balance it so that you are not abusing your DM's powers to, you know, punish the players. So you want to realistically, you know, model what they would know in a way that demonstrates their absolute competence, but not in a way that becomes frustrating for the players. So this is a challenging one, but it is very fun to go up against a competent villain. This is the one that your players will love to hate. If they are realistically defeated by an equal cunning foe, they're going to love going up against them.
Man, let me ask my man over here. Hey, man, let me ask you a question, man. See if you know what's up. Pick this. Who fuses the music with no illusions? Producing the blueprints, clueless automator, defy the laws of nature. Electronic monolith, throw a jam upon the disc. The futuristic looping with the quickness. Hyperproducing hydrogen fusion liquids. Keep your distance. Keep your distance. Who's that?
The mastermind.
Okay. It is the Xanatos of the Xanatos Gambit, an ancient TV trope, where they just appear to have an answer for everything, but they're basically making it up as they go. This is Yarlaxle Bainra from Waterdeep Dragon Heist, where it's kind of ridiculous and obvious that their plans are being made up on the fly, but it works in such a way that is interesting and compelling. And both of these villains are not as sinister as others might be. They're sort of more of an antagonist than an actual, like, evil enemy. So it works that they always seem to have an answer. They always have a smoke bomb at the ready. They always have, you know, a trap door, or, you know, they rip off a mask and it's like, aha, I've been Yarlaxle Bainra the whole time. So be careful with this one, because having a hyper-competent villain that's just always has an answer for everything is very frustrating, but it can be good for sort of a less evil and more antagonistic foe, one that is throwing a wrench rather than, you know, killing people.
For 90% of your campaigns, you're better off going the other end of this archetype spectrum with a villain who is coming up with wily coyote style ridiculous plans that are easily foiled by your heroes, who, you know, put on their villain costume for their guards,
yeah,
and no one can see their face. That's way better, right?
Usually,
you know,
better.
There's nothing worse than, you know, being like, well, maybe we'll sneak through the ventilation ducts. Nope, they're too small.
Yeah.
Okay, we'll disguise ourselves as one of the guards. Nope.
They all have ID badges, yeah. This is generally not fun,
yeah,
but it can be in the right circumstance, especially if you have a very experienced group and one that likes a challenge and one the kinds that like to plan. You know, give them a villain that also likes to plan.
I just like having villains who think they are really good, and give them a couple opportunities to demonstrate their competence, and then eventually when the players defeat them, It feels nice.
It feels nice. It feels nice.
All right, shall we get even more specific? Okay, let's build some first. We got to put our money in the mouth and then end with some player ones. Yeah.
So, as we have discussed, the world of Anima Mundi is my working world building project. I have mentioned, you know, the main action takes place or starts in the city of what is still vaguely called Darien. It is a coastal city where many different people groups and powers come together. I've also mentioned that I like the idea of ancient underwater civilizations. So my primary big bad is I am imagining a great Khan of the Sea. Probably a Sahuagin.
Khan of the Sea. No dolphins were harmed in making this game.
A Sahuagin, but a charismatic one. One that rather than...
Oh, well, I guess dolphins were harmed if it was a Swaggin.
Almost certainly some dolphins were harmed in the making of this film.
Yeah, you should... When the players meet this villain, they should be dining on dolphin flesh.
Absolutely.
I mean, if you want to go really dark.
I mean, yeah.
Uncheck that harmed animals box.
And, yeah, they just sort of unite all of the sea races under a banner, and they want to, you know, either... yoke all coastal peoples to the Sahuagin, Khanate, or, I don't know, plunge the entire world back into primordial ocean. You know, melt the ice caps and, somewhere in between those two. We'll work on the specifics, but, you know, I like the idea of a great Khan of the Sea who can have many, many agents, both land-going and sea-going, to challenge and threaten the player characters as the scope of the campaign grows.
So motivation clear, attack those air breathing surface dwellers.
Yes.
Does this villain, you know, one thing we haven't talked about yet, but this is why we're getting into specifics, have a flaw? Is there the sort of thing that they can't see? What is their flaw? Is it their faith in their friends? Is it their overconfidence?
It's overconfidence. This is not a particularly unique villain. This Sahuagin Khan is strong, smart, charismatic, surrounded by competent advisors, you know, ascendant, has never failed or very rarely failed, you know, has a plan for everything, is personally and professionally strong, right? Has no reason to believe that there is anything that could ever challenge his or her ascendance. And plan to, you know, conquer the world. That is, I would say, the main flaw. But of course, this Sahuagin has never encountered the player characters before.
Okay, I will similarly start out at the sort of highest level with some big threats. This is for my world, Wild Space, which is fantasy, spelljammer, fantasy, spelljammer, galaxy, in space. So my first villain is Terminus. He is from another dimension, and I just had in my mind a picture of a beefy skeleton lich dude in shining armor, sort of like flying through space, blowing up planets. And from there, I went with, you know, what would this person want? I'm like, oh, well, maybe they're from an alternate reality, a different plane of existence. One of my favorite space TV tropes is... or sci-fi TV tropes that should be imported into fantasy is alternate dimensions. And for reasons of his own, which the players can discover. He wants to end every other dimension but his own. Perhaps he believes that as a lich who is immortal, that his life and actions have no meaning as long as there are other worlds and possibilities that negate his choices.
That's great. I love the idea of an armored lich flying through space. I want to airbrush it on the side of my van. It's incredible. So we talked about motivations. What are his methods? How does reality-destroying lich gather allies and or friends or, you know, minions to his cause? Or does he just conquer by sheer lichy might?
I think it's conquest by sheer lichy might. And since he is immortal and has backup on backup from his phylacteries, he goes from dimension plane to plane, discovers in each one a way to end the existence from some terrifying death ship, and then attempts to pull it off, right? I could also see that he's, you know, it could be a character where he just wants to conquer the multiverse and rule. But I thought, you know, ending is just
that's more interesting. And I guess if he's a lich, he can just create his own minions, right? Golems and other right. undead and whatnot.
Which is his big flaw. He is a brilliant mind working in brilliant ways, but he is just one mind, right? All of his other subordinates and things are you know, don't have too much initiative on their own, and that is the probably best avenue for players defeating him.
Do we want to posit some smaller ones, or?
Yeah, I've got one or two smaller ones.
So yeah, I've got another smaller one too, and this is actually somebody that I've sort of built out, and it is a I've mentioned that Darien has a number of gangs. And I love the minor villain that comes back. And so I have built out largely in my mind a minor, sniveling, pathetic underling of one of the smaller gangs in Darien. You know, somebody that the players will, a were-rat.
Your players are always going to love a villain that just is completely unlikable, who is cowardly and has very few redeeming virtues, right? They're not strong.
A were-rat named Sniv, who hopefully they will spare, but who is so cowardly, so pathetic and undermining, but that continues to rise, right? As the players, you know, overtake all these other gangs and break up these criminal organizations, Sniv and his, you know, grasping, greedy ways will continue to get more and more powerful. And perhaps he is not quite as weak and cowardly as he seems. Perhaps there is a craven cunning to him. I'm imagining this sort of as like a low mid-level big bad, somebody who they will eventually have to face in a much more powerful form. But one of my favorite is just the sniveling... I love to hate these guys. Wormtongue is a great example of this type of just love to hate. Just absolute...
Right. The sidekick.
Loathsome type of person, but a good villain.
My sort of mid-tier villain that, you know, is one of those villains that will emerge as important if the players end up liking it is the Ambassador. My world is dominated by big galactic empires, and having... ambassadors from them in the player's home system. It's something I want to do. One of the ambassadors is going to be from the evil or semi-evil Draconic Empire, and they are incredibly unhappy, right? This is going back to my idea of the person who wants out. Incredibly unhappy with their position as ambassador. They were perhaps demoted, or they feel that they should be in a more important position. And all they want is to get out, right? And so they are likely to, you know, help the player characters, right? But maybe one of their methods for getting out is to rekindle a war between the player's home system and some evil empire so they can return to their position in military command or move up the ranks. So, you know, they may be willing to give the players access to new magical artifacts and stuff to increase the power of their own, you know, home base, The players may not realize until it's too late, right, that this could destabilize the entire galaxy. This is the Ghul Dukat stolen type thing.
Yeah, no, and
it's just my favorite.
We talked about this when you brought it up as the archetype, but it's one of my favorites. It's such a good one. It's compelling. It's something to chew on, right? You know, thematically and in terms of character. Yeah, it's a solid. Okay,
should we get to some? So we've done some. We've talked about the big ideas. Let's hear from some listeners for some fun villain ideas.
Born in the dark of love, facing the winds of fate, storms brewing up above. I was breaking, I was begging. Just to raise you up from the grave of your mistakes. Pleasure is a kind of pain. Have I had enough? 'Cause I keep wrestling with snakes. Sick of all the slippery stuff. Are you Jekyll and Hyde in me? Silently, I can't see in the dark. Are you Jekyll or Hyde this time? Where's my mind? I can't sleep in the dark. Jekyll and Hyde.
A call on Twitter to
and our henchmen responded
some unexpected
and women
or unassuming big bad evil guys and or gals. So we have, as of the recording of this, exactly 12 responses. So Matt, I say we roll a 12-sided die and work on putting together a brief outline of whatever we come up with. Okay, so Matt, will you do me the honor of rolling a 12-sided die?
Here we go. All right, that's a 4, Rob.
All right, 4 is from at Simon T. Vesper, who suggests a street orphan assassin guildmaster. And I am so glad we landed on this one, because I have a great idea for this, and the idea that I have is that I want to make a Newsies villain. I want to make a little singing Christian Bale in a hat. Ooh. That organizes the newspaper boys of some city, except instead of being like, hey, we're fighting for, you know, union dues, he actually just wants to, like, you know, kneecap all of the, you know, the free press and, you know, bend the city to his will. I think this is such
a great idea, especially if you make your villains young, right? You know, you can give your players, you know, oh man, our opponent is a 13-year-old child. Shit.
Yeah, right. Yeah, how are you gonna fight a child?
Let's stat out a fun way to put this into a campaign. I think idea that immediately comes to mind is the players just take out some evil crime organization, or you have it in your background of your campaign that a new just ruler or ruling system has come to whatever place you are and have eliminated some terrible crime family or something. However, the unintended consequence of either of these actions is that who's taking over the Assassin's Guild? Well, I guess it's these street orphans who are now running things.
Yeah. Yeah. This is a great way to start, is that your villain comes out of the unintended consequence of something good, right? You know, one evil family was dethroned, a crime syndicate was broken up, an evil empire was shattered, but without the, you know, the influence of this objectively bad but stabilizing force, something equally sinister has risen up in its place. And this time, it is a street gang of youths who have taken over all the assassins contracts that the Assassin's Guild no longer has.
Okay, let's see if we can give this character a couple specific traits and, you know, possible, like, slightly more detailed motivations.
Sure. Okay, so let's make them, hang on. I'm pulling up a list of Victorian boys' names. I'm going to pick one at random. Let's call this boy Nathaniel, or Nate.
Nate.
Maybe even let's give him something alliterative. Let's call him Naughty Nate.
All right. Rob's made it a little too sexual for me.
Hang on. But all right. Hang on.
Naughty Nate. And is in charge of, let's say, what sort of skills would they have that would allow them to take over the Assassin's Guild? You know, maybe they were part of just a artful dodger type.
They're pickpockets.
Nate has acquired a hat of disguise, which has allowed him to take over whatever assassin business that was put out.
Ooh,
of things.
This is smart.
And Nate has found out that, in fact, having little Victorian orphans, they can go almost anywhere, right? They can get into the kitchens of any place in the entire city, and it's made them very good assassins.
Yeah, so right?
They often use poison and other less direct ways.
Because they're not strong enough to, garrote or murder somebody, right? They use poison daggers or just drop poison in soups or porridges, right?
The soup killers. What is Nate's motivation?
Nate's motivation is that Nate's an orphan. Nate had a rough upbringing. He was, left on the street by his, his parents who either were dead or didn't care for him. He was treated poorly, abused by, some generic nunnery or orphanage or monastery, church organization. So he went out on the street. And, he's got standard living in poverty, struggle needs. He never wants to be poor again. He never wants to, not be in control. He never wants to feel afraid ever again. And so he just keeps gathering more and more power to himself as much as he possibly can.
Exactly. I like this motivation. If it was in my campaign, I might take it in just sort of a slightly more sympathetic direction.
Sure.
Of just confusion, right?
Yeah, that's
in
fair.
That, Nate has acquired power and wealth, and he honestly doesn't know what to do with
this.
It
is more sympathetic, right? He sort of...
But you could go with either one of them.
Maybe he fell ass first into head of the Assassin's Guild, and now he doesn't know what to do, and he definitely can't go back, right? So he's got to try to maintain. Both are good. Matt's is more sympathetic if you want him to be more likable.
Just wait for the looks on your players' faces when they reveal that the evil assassin king or queen is in fact a child.
And also
a child could easily run a good assassin.
Oh yeah,
skill.
Well,
honestly,
this is a
pretty
good idea.
Way bad at this.
And
this is the Ender's Game theory of villains.
It is.
In that Ender's the children are way better at.
Oh,
being
for sure. Evil. Well, and then of course you've got maybe you take it apart and you're like, well, these children participated in dozens of murders. How are we going to rehabilitate an entire guild of murderous children?
You will be assassins for good from now on. All right. Any other things we want to say about this one, Rob? I'd love to share each of our favorite ones that our listeners.
Thanks to Simon T. Vesper for a great suggestion. What was your favorite of our listener submissions?
Okay, I had a couple, but if I have to pick one, someone sent in as the big bad evil of your campaign, an animated rug
that
speaks in
that
sign language.
That was mine, too. It was my favorite,
leads
too.
A revolt among other constructs forced into servitude.
I love this.
And
I love this idea. Yeah.
I love this idea, too. I would probably take it in a turn it up to 11 direction, in that the rug that got animated is, in fact, one of those artifact rugs. It's the tapestry of time, or it's the rug of fate, or something like that, so that, the rug has some magical powers as well. And if you made, for example, an object of destiny itself sentient, what would it do?
And yeah, either legitimately or not legitimately, it believes that all objects have sentience like it does, and so its goal is to animate every inanimate thing and, free them from the shackles of servitude. And so you have an ever-growing infinite army of, animated chairs and houses, and, the original object has the power to make more and oh god, a little silly, but honestly, like a pretty great idea. And I would absolutely use this for a villain in my campaign for sure.
Absolutely, this is one of those great villains that's like, this is the villain of the fourth level of Dungeon X, right?
Yes,
it could be a world-spanning villain to be sure. But it could also be a villain of one level of a dungeon.
This is where, you know, when you encounter, like, mid-dungeon or in, like, a town that's gone dark and you find, oh, yeah, this is what's happened here. Yeah.
Wait a second. So the raiders attacked your village and instead of stealing your gold or children, they took all your shovels, brooms, and spare cloaks? That's okay.
How unusual.
How are we going to solve this mystery? This is very strange. Sir, we're dealing with we got a bad case of the borrowers here.
yeah, thank you to at level 2 NPC for a very, very good suggestion.
Yeah, this one made me think of another villain that I really was thinking about because we're getting leaks about the new Eberron sourcebook. My favorite monster from Eberron is the idea of a living spell, right?
Ooh, yeah.
Oh, so you've got a fireball that just keeps rolling around, blowing things up. It could be a simple opponent like that, but I've always thought a fun living dominate monster would be incredibly interesting, awakened in the same way as this rug, trying to find its purpose, knowing that as an entity of pure magic, it can only interact with the world by dominating people and switching from dominating person to person. And, you know, there's a lot you could work in with that, with players trying to figure out exactly who they're fighting.
Yeah. Ooh, that's good. That's clever. Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Since we had the same favorite one, what would be your what's a secondary favorite one?
I also really liked, there was a suggestion that either the moon or a star was behind everything.
Kill the moon.
Kill the moon. Yeah, I have a number of different ways to like make this make sense, but I love the idea of like the players have to blow up the moon. That's exactly the kind of fun, wacky thing that I would like to put in a campaign. Yeah.
What does the moon want?
The moon wants to be closer to the Earth, in such a way that,
just want to hug you, Tiger.
That it's like destroying the tides.
Or the moon is in fact like the shell of some, you know, celestial being or god or something like that. And
yeah,
jealous that it is barren and void. It has no life.
That's right.
And it wants to either destroy life on Earth or begin moving people to the moon.
Or,
which will kill most of
them. The moon wants out. The moon has sentience. And the moon is tired of being bound to the celestial body. And it wants to be free. But if it does that, it'll destroy the planet. You know, it'll throw all the, like, tectonic plates and tides into chaos and sink all the continents. And so the players have to stop the moon from leaving. Ooh, that's pretty good, actually. You know, you gotta, like, you know, it just wants to be free, but you can't let it do that.
The only way to stop the moon is to get a bunch of Florida men and women to, like, raise their guns in the air.
To fire.
Shoot them.
Shoot the moon at once.
There we go. That's what we call the campaign.
Shoot the moon. Oh, my God. This is great. We got to write this.
This could be a fun one-shot. Right?
Yeah, shoot the moon. That's actually pretty funny. Like, a really high-level campaign one-shot, like a level 20 one-shot where players have to literally shoot the moon.
Look out, moon. America's gonna get you. Gonna go kaboom. Nice to adventure, cause you don't mess around with God's America.
Thank you for everyone who sent us in suggestions.
Yeah.
We had such fun reading them, and sorry we didn't get to
more. Thank you all for participating. We'll do more of these. We have some other, like, more niche world-building episodes to cover, but we've hit a lot of our main topics. So if there's something you want to hear about specifically, absolutely write us. Or add us on Twitter. So dmofnone@gmail.com, add us on Twitter, @dmofnone.
Or give us a call at the Dungeon Master Hotline, 774-203-4629.
That's right. And as always, thank you all for listening, and keep rolling them dice.